your license in my wallet when we go out downtown. Your lipstick stained every coffee cup that I got in this house. The way you say I love you too is like rain on an old tin roof. And your hand fits right into mine like a needle in a groove. Some things just go better together, and probably always will. Like a cup of coffee and a sunrise, Sunday drives and time to kill. What's the point of this old guitar if it ain't got no strings? Or pouring your heart into a song that you ain't gonna sing. It's a match made up in heaven, like good old boys and beer and me, as long as you're right here. Sometimes we're oil and water, but I wouldn't have it any other way. And if I'm being honest, your first and my last name would just sound better together, and probably always will. Like a cup of coffee and a sunrise, Sunday drives and time to kill. What's the point of this on guitar if it ain't got no strings? Or pouring your heart into a song that you ain't gonna sing. It's a match made up in heaven, like good old boys and beer and me, as long as you're right here. And me, as long as you're right here.
From Philippians chapter 2. Therefore, if any of you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus.
Good afternoon, everyone. And I want to welcome you today on behalf of Gabriel and Adriel. And I want to thank you for coming and welcome all of you, of course, to share in this special day, this special occasion, as they share their wedding vows. And before we move ahead, I can't resist making a few extraordinary comments on some extraordinary things here. First of all, I've been in the ministry almost 50 years, and I don't think I've ever had a better cool rhyme. It's Gabriel and Adriel. Isn't that great? That's great. Gabriel and Adriel. You're made for each other, see? And then I also want to mention that the two fathers are both David. Both David. Also mentioned that they're both clergymen. And it just so happens that I'm Gabriel's grandfather, so we got plenty. If anything happens to me while I'm up here today, good backup. All right. And since this is a Christian marriage, we would like to begin, of course, with a word of prayer, acknowledging and honoring the Heavenly Father, who's the author of this divine institution of marriage. Let's bow and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the working of your providence in which Gabriel and Adriel have been brought together to create a Christian marriage. We seek to acknowledge you in all our ways, but especially as we undertake new relationships which will greatly impact the rest of our lives. And certainly, we acknowledge our dependency upon you in such an hour as this when two souls enter into the covenant relationship of marriage. We ask that you would mercifully grant your favor and your blessing upon this union of hearts, which is about to take place here today, and we ask it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Bible is rich in its teaching about the spiritual significance of marriage, which is extremely important, especially in the day and age we're living. The sinful world takes every good and beautiful thing that God has created, such as this divine institution of marriage, and abuses it and distorts it, sometimes almost beyond recognition. The profane and secular world, which refuses to see God in anything, views marriage as a product of social evolution, which some think may have already served its purpose and even be on the edge of extinction. And our society seeks to destroy the biblical model of marriage and to invent new definitions of marriage and of the family. And sometimes the world we live in today almost seems like the world of Noah's day when God judged the world with flood, or even the days of Sodom and Gomorrah where God destroyed the culture then by fire and brimstone from heaven. But there is a God in heaven who authored this creation and the institution of marriage. And both his creation and the institution of marriage itself are intended to reflect the glory and the majesty of his decency and his goodness and his moral sanity. The great English Baptist preacher Charles Spurgeon once wrote a morning devotional in which he brought out the spiritual significance of marriage. And Spurgeon referred to Genesis 2:24, and that verse says, "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall become one flesh." Now this, of course, was after the creation of Adam, the first man, and when God had created the man first, he says it's not good for the man to be alone. And so we're told in the Word of God that then he created Eve, the first woman. And then it was after that that the writer of Moses commented, therefore, that Moses, who was the writer of Genesis, commented, "Therefore shall a man leave his father and mother, cleave unto his wife, and the two shall become one flesh." So notice the blueprint for marriage in the Bible: leaving, cleaving, and becoming one flesh. Leaving, no parental or in-law interference in this new family. Cleaving, honoring the vow, the commitment, the covenant, a lifetime covenant. And then becoming one flesh, union, heart union that takes place as time goes by. Best friends, soulmates. Not good to be alone. It's not good to grow old alone. So great blessing here. But Spurgeon said about this verse, he says, "Passing all human union is the mystical cleaving to the church for which Christ left his Father and became one flesh with the church." Spurgeon recognized that marriage, this institution of marriage, is actually a divine institution in which God created to design and designed to be a picture and a symbol of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It speaks of the incarnation, for example, when Christ left the Father. See, leaving, cleaving, becoming one flesh. When Christ left the Father in heaven. John 1:14 says, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us." Speaking of the birth of Christ, the incarnation. Philippians 2, the Apostle Paul wrote how that Christ thought it not a thing to be grasped onto to be equal with the Father, but he lowered himself and made himself of no reputation and took upon himself the form of flesh and blood, all to redeem and purchase a people for his own out of this world, that is the church. And then secondly, cleaving. When we take communion every month or whenever you do that in the church, the juice represents, the wine represents the blood of Christ, and it represents the new covenant. It's called the blood of the new covenant. So even in what Christ is doing for the church in the gospel, it reflects the idea of the vow, the covenant. And then also it speaks of communion and unity, becoming one flesh. And as the years go by, just as the bride of Christ will be with Christ forever, and they'll enjoy the union together in heaven. It says, "In his presence is fullness of joy and pleasures forevermore." It is a symbol. It is a type of what this marriage is all about. And then Spurgeon said, "In heaven, they do not marry. But they, as Christ says, they are like the angels. They don't marry in heaven. And yet there is," Spurgeon said, "this one marvelous exception to that rule in heaven. And that is Christ and his church, who will celebrate their union together for all eternity." I would like for you to just listen before we go on with the rest of the ceremony here for a few references to this in the New Testament. Isaiah, or in the Bible. Isaiah 62 is an Old Testament verse written 750 years before Jesus was even born. And it says, as a bridegroom rejoices over his bride, so your God rejoices over you. He compares it to a bridegroom. In Revelation 19, at the end of the Bible, it says, let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb, that is Christ, has come. The wedding of the Lamb, Christ, has come. And his bride, the church, has made herself ready with fine linen, bright and clean. In Revelation 21, we read, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven, from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. See all the imagery in the Bible that refers to Christ and his church as the bride of Christ. Revelation 19 says, then the angel said to me, write, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. We'll have a celebration, a reception supper later on as a tradition in weddings. And it reflects the fact that God is going to have a great wedding supper of the Lamb in the final time when Christ receives his church, his bride, to himself. And then finally, one more in Isaiah 25 says, on this mountain the Lord Almighty will prepare a mighty feast, rich food for all people, but of aged wine, referring to the celebration of this union between God's Son, Jesus Christ, and his bride, the church. So therefore, whether mankind recognizes this or not, God has given a picture of the gospel in this institution of marriage. Now, Gabriel, as you stand here today before God and these witnesses, you are affirming in their presence your purpose to enter into a covenant relationship of marriage with Adriel and to become one flesh with her. You're therefore in a position to enter into all the joys and the blessings and the privileges of the marriage relationship. However, you're also affirming your willingness to accept the responsibility that comes with the role of a husband, to love your wife as Christ loves the church, and to treat her in an honorable way, and to provide for her, and to separate yourself from all others unto her alone, and to live with her as long as you both shall live. And furthermore, since you profess to seek a Christian marriage, you're also affirming your personal subjection to the principles of God's word and to the authority of Christ's church in this marriage relationship. So, Gabe, is this your purpose, and do you indeed affirm these things?
Yes, I do.
And Gabriel and Adriel, as you stand before God and these witnesses today, you're also affirming in their presence your purpose, which is to enter into covenant relationship of marriage with Gabriel and to become one flesh with him. You're also, therefore, in a position to enter into all the joys and the blessings and the privileges of the marriage relationship. But you also are affirming your willingness to accept the responsibilities which accompany the role of the wife. That is to love and honor Gabriel as your husband, and to separate yourself from all others unto him alone as long as you both shall live. And furthermore, since you also profess to seek a Christian marriage, you're also affirming your personal subjection to the principle of God's word and to the authority of Christ's church in this marriage relationship. So, Adriel and Gabriel, is this your purpose, and do you indeed affirm these things?
Yes, I do.
So now, Gabriel and Adriel, having made this clear affirmation of your purpose before God and these witnesses, you may now both come forward to share your wedding vows. Hands, you can give that to her. Okay. Hold, take hands. Okay. Now, the wedding vows are the most sacred part of the marriage ceremony because they are a formal and a public commitment made before Almighty God and many witnesses that the covenant that you're about to enter into today is holy and sacred and not to be violated. In these words, each of you promise with a holy vow to separate yourself from all others and to cling to each other as husband and wife until death. Therefore, let all who are present recognize fully the seriousness of these commitments before Almighty God. Now, Gabriel, in taking Adriel, whom you hold by the hand to be your wife, do you promise to live with her, to love and to cherish her, to honor and sustain her in sickness and in health, in poverty and in wealth, in sorrow and in joy, and to separate yourself from all others unto her alone, and to be faithful to her in all things until death alone shall part you? Do you so promise?
I do.
And Adriel, in taking Gabriel, who holds you by the hand to be your husband, do you promise to live with him, seeking to love and to cherish and to honor him in sickness as in health, in poverty as in wealth, in sorrow and in joy, and to separate yourself from all others unto him alone, and to be faithful unto him until death alone shall part you? Do you so promise?
Yes, I do.
Right. Now, Gabriel, what do you offer as a token of this vow?
A ring.
Very good. Good.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. Yeah. All right. Well, this ring will serve as a ceaseless reminder of this hour right now and of the vows that you have exchanged here today. And the ring is a circle, of course, and it signifies no end. Only God should separate, and only by death. The ring is also gold, and it's a metal that can stand the test. And frankly, you too are going to also have many testings. You'll not always agree. As long as there are two people on the face of the earth, there's going to be disagreement because we all have a sinful nature. But this does not give reason for either of you to leave, especially in the context of a Christian marriage. 2 Corinthians 9:8, we're told that God makes all grace, he'll give you all grace that will abound towards you to make you sufficient unto every good work. And this is especially true for those who believe his promises. And another one, 1 Corinthians 10:13, he says he'll not allow any trial to overtake you, but such as is common to man. He's faithful, and he'll give you grace to see you through every trial. And in Romans 8:28 says he's always going to be working in the circumstances to work all things together for good to them that love the Lord and called according to his purpose. So Gabe, as you place this ring on your bride's finger, repeat these words after me. I, Gabriel,
take this ring
in token of my pledge of love and faithfulness. And as I place it upon your finger, I renew my vows before Almighty God. And Adria, what do you offer as a token of your vows?
A ring.
Place the ring on Gabe's finger. Yeah. Repeat these words after me.
I, Adriel,
take this ring.
In token of my pledge of love and faithfulness.
And as I place it upon your finger, I renew my vows before Almighty God.
I renew my vows before the Almighty God.
Very good. All right, now shall we bow as we ask God's blessing on the union that's taking place here today. We thank you, Father, for the providence which brings human hearts into the bonds of human love that's compared in Scripture with the love of Christ and his church. Pray that you'll accept in heaven your dwelling place, the union of hearts, which has here been confessed before you, and let your blessing rest upon it. Grant that the ties which bind these, your servants, may grow stronger with the passing of years. May they trust each other with perfect confidence, and together trust in you for guidance and help in all the way that lies before them. Prosper them in temporal things according to your purpose and grace, but most especially lead them into the bounty of your spiritual riches of grace in Christ Jesus. For it's in his name, which is above all names, that we pray. Amen. And now, inasmuch as you both have willingly affirmed this covenant together and taken these pledges of your affections and vows of fidelity and have witnessed the same before God and these witnesses present here today, as a minister of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by sanction of divine authority, I do hereby affirm and pronounce that you are Gabriel Michael Groves and Adriel Anna Katzma, are lawfully married as husband and wife in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. What therefore God has joined together, let no man put asunder. And you may kiss the bride. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Mr. and Mrs. Gabriel Michael Groves.